Livingston Family Dentistry knows the value of a healthy, beautiful smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston and their friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. So whether it's routine dentistry, cosmetic improvement, or complete restoration, bring your smile back to life at Livingston Family Dentistry, located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park. Call now, 313-883-3050. If your teeth are not becoming to you,
then you should be coming to us.
Good morning, and welcome to the Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 90 and 91, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web at www.tv33whpr.com. And of course, we have the WHPR app that you could get on your phone and that you can watch us anywhere, just anywhere. It's amazing. Technology is amazing. Before I begin with my great guest this morning, I have a wonderful, wonderful show for you. And we are doing Table Talk right after this show. And you know there's a lot to talk about. You know, Donald Trump will be in town tomorrow. But anyway, there's a lot we're going to talk about, and maybe you want to call in and chime in on that. So that starts at 10 o'clock. Now, tomorrow is the fourth annual Lupus Walk for Warriors, and it starts at New Center Park down on West Grand Boulevard. So I'd like people who to be encouraged and to come out and to either participate or watch or encourage the people who are walking. It's a great significance to me and many of the people who worked at Southfield High School when a young man named Jeff Vernon Parker, he went to Southfield. He was one of my students and just very well liked. Well, he passed away earlier this year from lupus, and people are walking in his name, but there's an event tonight also at Shields Restaurant and Bar and Pizzeria. You know, that's on 10 Mile and Telegraph. They're going to be raising funds for the foundation because they're, you know, creating a foundation. And if you bring a flyer, you could get a flyer on your phone, you could dine in or carry out. 20% of all food purchases without discount, that means showing the flyer, will go towards Team Jeff Vernon Parker's post. Team Jeff Vernon Parker will be there to kick off the Saturday Lupus Walk from 6 p.m. to 12 a.m. I'm sorry. And so today from 11 a.m. to tonight, 12 a.m., you could go up to Shields, and they have pretty good food, and you can, they'll donate so much of the money to the Jeff Parker Fund for the foundation, because lupus is a very debilitating disease that can take you out. I know my cousin has it, and she's in town right now, and she's in remission, which is wonderful. But, you know, everybody doesn't get that opportunity. And this young man, just a wonderful young man, voice was silenced by this disease, unfortunately. So now I have someone on who, well, first and foremost, let me tell you, my second guest is Jeff. Jesse, I'm sorry, how did I do that? Jesse will be on second. Jesse is a motivational speaker, and he and I had a great conversation, and it's going to be even greater. And then I have Tegas Taylor on, and she has a wonderful, wonderful story about what she's doing for young people. In this time where we're able to go back to school, the young people are going back to school, there are other skills that they have to learn that they don't teach in school anymore. Isn't that correct?
That's correct, yes.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. My organization is called Gifting Dreamers, and what Gifting Dreamers does is we offer free life skill classes and mentoring for kids that are 10 to 17 years old. It's completely free. You just register or you show up to the class on Saturday mornings. They're always held on Saturday mornings from 10 until noon, and we teach a variety of different life skills that the kids are needing to have to be a well-rounded person, as well as, you know, learning their...
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, let's hear a little about you and why you decided to do this, because what Tegas is offering is great, and we have a video that we're going to show later about it. It's called Gifted Dreamers Video, and I think that that's something that we'll all want to look at and see. In fact, it's so heartfelt. It's very heartfelt, so I'll be calling for that in just a few minutes. But Tegas, tell us a little about yourself.
I am a mother of two boys, and I started Gifting Dreamers out of a sense of necessity. I am a human resource director by trade, and I noticed when kids were coming in, or definitely the fresh out of college students, that they had the education because they had gone to college, but they were missing that next piece, which was the how to be prepared to go into the workforce, how to interview, how to look, how to be present in an interview. And so I started looking at going further and looked in the high schools, and I realized that kids were missing that step between education and the real world. And so I developed the program to start teaching life skill classes, which are things that used to be taught in school, but are no longer taught in school.
So those life skill classes, what are they comprised of?
They're comprised of different areas in your life that you need, like health and wellness, etiquette, social etiquette, talking about things like social media. It's a wonderful thing, but then it can also be detrimental to your future.
Absolutely.
We talk about safety in our communities and in our homes. We talk about anger management, peer pressuring, bullying, all of the things that kids are needing, you know, to help cope or to help get along in today's society.
And you know, it's funny because sometimes kids will listen to other people rather than their parents.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Who knows? So we have a video of what you're doing. So if we're ready, we can put on the video.
I'd like everybody to, in just 2 minutes, tell us their name and how old they are, and then we'll go ahead and get started.
My name is Saray, and I'm 15.
Hi, I'm Terrell, and I'm 13.
Hi, my name is Tariana Jones. I'm 17 years old.
My name is Deontay, and I'm 12 years old.
Hello, I am Tegas Cavetti, founder of Gifting Dreamers Foundation. Gifting Dreamers is a life skills mentoring program which empowers and inspires youth ages 10 to 17 to dream, aspire, and succeed. Gifting Dreamers provides free weekly classes called Young Lady Dreamers, Young Men Dreamers, and Financial Fitness for Dreamers on subjects like health and wellness, grooming, safety, finances, career visioning, career shadowing, and volunteerism. Growing up as an at-risk youth myself, I know if it was not for the educational and spiritual mentors that I encountered, I would not be the first college graduate in my family. I want every youth in Metro Detroit who has a dream for a better, productive, and positive life to achieve their dream. We are Gifting Dreamers.
What happens is that it's oxidizing.
I've worked a lot throughout the last two programs that I've been to,
and it's educational. We learned health, and today we're learning makeup, so it's really fun.
You don't have to be like everybody else. You're beautiful in your own way. And it's a bonding thing with other people that you've never met before. Everybody's friendly, and it's something that we need to do in the community to keep us out.
How do you like the Gifting Dreamers program?
I think it's cool. It's kind of nice.
What have you learned by going to the program?
Learned about personal hygiene, learned about the police, and learned being safe around liquor stores and the streets.
I've learned that sometimes you can make new friends. Like, if you don't want to go somewhere, then when you go to that place, you end up having new friends, and you don't have to, like, sit at home all day and play video games, where you could just go to the program and experience new things every day.
That was wonderful, wonderful. In fact, it's so heartfelt because the kids were just talking from their hearts.
Thank you.
Oh, my goodness. Now, let's tell the audience about this a little more. Let's get a little more into depth about it. Where do you find the kids, or the kids find you?
The kids can find me on our website, which is giftingdreamers.com.
Giftingdreamers.com.
Yep, they can go on there. We have a Facebook page, we have a Twitter, we have an Instagram page. Also, DPS, we're in a lot of the middle school and high schools as far as the information about us. So they can get it from a counselor or the principal's office.
So what is there some requirement to be involved or what?
Just that you're between that age of 10 to 17 is the requirement, yeah.
And
if you want to learn something new and have a new experience.
Oh, wow. This, you know, exposure is everything. Can you tell us a couple of things about some of the kids on the video?
Yeah. One of the girl on the video that spoke first, her name is Sheree. She just recently went to Nicaragua on a missions trip because another thing that Gifting Dreamers is very fond of is volunteering and missions. And she said it was her first time out of the country. It was her first real trip, really. And she said it was the best experience that she's ever had. And I think life is about experiences. It's more so than looking outside of where you currently are, but to look at what the world has to offer. And I think a lot of times kids don't get that opportunity. And through missions and helping other people, I think that that's a great way to do it as well. Also, Deontay was a kid on the video, and he comes from a family where his mother is really young, and he, you know, the mother and him want to, want to have new experiences. She was a teenage mother, and she wants different from him, and he wants different from himself. He's a grade ahead. He's really trying hard in school. He's 12, but he's going into the 8th grade. So he has the drive and the passion. So we want to be there to help support him in, you know, getting to that next step and keep going.
And part and parcel of everything is getting these young people to be ready for the world, ready to meet people.
Correct.
And I noticed that you just had an event that taught them about eye contact and handshaking. Mm-hmm. That's very important.
Yeah.
Eye contact, because a lot of times some of our young people, they'll talk to people, but they won't look them in the eye. You know, and that's something that we always, well, I learned early, you got to look at people mm-hmm. in the eye.
Mm-hmm.
Because I noticed that my father did not always look people in the eye, the head down. But then he came from a different generation. He came from a different place.
Yeah. And that was a big class because our two classes that we hold are Young Lady Dreamers classes, and those are specifically for girls. We teach the same thing in that as well as our Young Men Dreamers classes. And when we had the Young Men Dreamers, the Omega Sci-Fi guys came in and taught the class for gentlemen on how to shake hands, look in the eye, pull your pants up. And it was amazing how, you know, it was natural once the boys got it to give a firm handshake. You know, when you're meeting somebody, you speak up. You know, you have not composure, but you have, you know, you have
confidence.
There's the word. You have confidence with yourself. Say your name. My name is John. You know, and mean it. And don't feel ashamed or scared because the person is bigger than you or older or even maybe more established than you. You still should be secure in who you are as a young man.
Well, I think some of these skills too transfer to the classroom.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
And you have here this is the girls, but safety and self-defense training with Officer Gaines of the Detroit Police Department.
Yes, we also offer that for young men. And we're with the young men, we're also working on surviving the stop because that's been very prevalent in the media Black Lives Matter and the officers and the gentlemen that have been, lives have been taken. So we want them to have that conversation with police officers. Have that conversation. What should I do? I've had plenty of boys that come and say, you know, I saw such and such on YouTube, and what should I do? If they stop me walking down the street or driving in the car, what should I do? So we set it up so that they can have that face-to-face conversation. And officer saying, this is how you should approach and this is what you should say, and even telling them what their rights are.
Right. I think I'm going to ask you this. I'm going to ask Jesse Cole this. At what age should men, young men especially, start carrying ID?
I think as soon as they start offering it in school, which is middle school, I think you should start carrying your ID on your person.
That's probably right. That's probably right, because you always, it's a shame. You got to identify yourself and be able to back it up, unfortunately or fortunately.
Or just in case something happens. If something happens and you fall and hit your head, somebody knows who you are.
They know who you are and who to call, you know, Ghostbusters. No, I couldn't help it. But you also have the vision board for the young ladies, and that's a wonderful thing too. Who do you see yourself, or what are you aspiring to? Mm-hmm. Isn't that correct?
Yeah. We talk a lot about what are your dreams, and that's where the name Gifting Dreamers comes in, because I truly believe that if you use your God-given talent and you hone it, it can be that you just like to scratch on paper. Scratching on paper turns into books. Scratching on paper turns into art on the wall. Scratching on paper turns into videos. Scratching on paper turns into anything your heart's desire. And if you use what you're really truly good at, it will take you, you can't even imagine the places that it can take you. So we really focus on, you know, now that you're starting to learn these skills, what is it that makes your heart sing? Because I truly believe that you can make it and you can do anything if you do what is truly your passion.
Absolutely. And there's something that you have on here that you're training the boys, I guess the girls too, on grooming.
Mm-hmm.
That's very important. Using deodorant is very important.
Mm-hmm.
My grandson is 10 years old. And he came in the house. I said, does I smell? He wears cologne every day. I said, cologne? He said, yes, Grammy. Yeah, he wears deodorant and cologne at 10. I said, oh, geez. I mean, but you have to teach them about deodorant.
Yeah, because a lot of our boys, like I said, the program starts at the age of 10. Between that 10 to 13, our hormones are changing and our bodies go from little boys and little girl bodies to, you know, things are starting to develop and perspire. And therefore, we like to teach them how to properly take care of themselves, be it from the girl standpoint and the boy standpoint.
Do you have a gentleman who teaches the guys?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we have a host of different gentlemen in the Detroit community that come in, that they specialize in the area that we're teaching in, and they come in and talk to them.
Oh, that's excellent. That is excellent. And that thing you mentioned about the pants being up.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's important.
Yes, that's very important. It's very important. And even one of the guys from Omega Sci-Fi, and I didn't even think about it, but he had said to the boys, he said, okay, think about this. You're walking with a girl that you like, and your pants are all hanging out. Do you think that she's like feels good being with you like that. And the boys didn't even think about that before. Like, he said, you're walking around showing your underwear with, when you're with a young lady. Do you think she's embarrassed by that?
I tell you, I've seen it. So, I mean, the pants are down like almost under the hip line.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't know. Here's the argument. And you can look it up on the internet or wherever you go for your information, is the fact that they said more young men were getting hip replacement surgery because they're walking wide-legged mm-hmm. like this. To hold the pants up. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm in the car and I'm stopping at a light and I see a guy. I mean, the belt is around the bottom of their hip.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. I see the underwear and I'm just saying, who told you that was cute? I just want to put my window down and say, pull up your pants. You know?
And it's got to be uncomfortable holding your pants up all day long.
Yeah. I see people walking around. They only have one hand available because mm-hmm. they let
holding
it go
their
out.
Pants,
you
yeah.
know,
mm-hmm.
it's like that. But you have a New Year's Eve party for them?
Yes. This year we're going to have a New Year's Eve party for our kids. One, it's a good way to keep the kids off the street, but then two, to bring them together, the girls and the boys, because they don't typically don't do class together. But for them to get together and socialize, they've been going to classes together, so it's a good way for them to hang out. It's going to be like an all-night party lock-in. That will also be free, and just have a good time welcoming in 2017.
Absolutely. And say, what are my goals for this
yeah,
year?
Yeah.
You know, that's
what we're
New Year's
talk about. Mm-hmm.
New Year's Eve is a great time for setting goals. Mm-hmm. And that's what a lot of people do. And you have a graduation.
Yep, we do a graduation day once they finish the 10-week program. And because we do social etiquette and how to dress and how to eat and how to do that, we all get all dressed up nice and fancy. We go out to a nice dinner, and we use all the skills that we have learned.
Well, you talked about etiquette and eating. Now, let's talk about that real quick. Some people, they may eat one way in the house,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
but they shouldn't necessarily eat that way outside of the house.
But I see it all the time, and a lot of kids don't. And like I said, that was a skill that used to be taught in school. I remember learning it in middle school.
Well, the one thing about it is, if you, for example, they're okay. Mm-hmm. If you, I remember my son, it was in ninth grade. And I swear, he wanted to, you know, he was going to take a girl to the homecoming. The girl's mother had arranged a limousine mm-hmm. or some old stuff. I said, I don't believe in all that. But had arranged it so that they can go to homecoming. And I said, Ryan, you're going to dinner before homecoming. He said, I'm not eating in front of a girl. But I had been telling him all the time, eat like this, eat like that. You know, you try and teach mm-hmm, those things mm-hmm. at home, but it was when he had to eat in front of a girl
yep,
that mm-hmm. he finally got that together,
mm-hmm,
you know.
Yeah.
And see, that's what's so good about your program. When you get them together, boys want to, you know.
Impress the girls.
They do.
Yeah. So when that's even how, when the guy said it about impressing the girl by pulling up your pants, I was like, that worked. Because a lot of times I think they hear their parents saying, oh, pull your pants up, or your mom. And you're like, yeah, ma, you're old school. But when another girl, when a girl, somebody you're trying to impress is like, oh, that doesn't look good. Or all of a sudden that attitude changes. It does.
It absolutely does. So let's kind of recap and tell our parents how to get in touch with you. What times a day, by the way? I mean, when do they meet? What?
Classes are Saturday mornings from 10 to noon. The girls' classes are held at Little Big World, which is 310 Livernois Avenue in Ferndale, just at 8 Mile in Livernois. And they start at 10 and they're over about 12. We always try to provide something to eat during the class so that if you miss breakfast or something, you'll be all set. And then the gentlemen's classes are on Saturday mornings as well. And they are at the Joe Dumars Fieldhouse in Detroit, which is at 8 Mile in Woodward. The next girls class is September 17th, and that will be the one with Officer Gaines, and it'll be on self-safety, self-defense, and dating. Safety, actually, with Officer Gaines from Detroit Police Department. And our next boys class is September 10th, and that also will be on safety, because we're doing our 2 weeks of safety. So, and that'll be on surviving the stop and safety in the neighborhood, and that will be with Officer King.
So how do people sign up?
They sign up by going to giftingdreamers.com. That's GIFTING Dreamers, DREAMERS.com, and you can just click on registration on the front page, or you can email us at giftingdreamers@gmail.com, and you can we can get you registered that way as well.
That's excellent, excellent. What if people have questions? Is there any number or anything?
Yes, they can give us a call at area code 248-722-1110.
This is a great program, program. I really appreciate it. I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
You know, this was one of my students one time.
Mm-hmm. Sure
but
was.
But I'm just so proud of you, very, very much so. So, everybody, stay tuned for Mr. Jesse Cole Jr., and we will be with him in a minute. And Tegas Taylor, thank you. GiftingDreamers.com, everyone. And that's a wonderful site, too. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We'll be back in just a moment.
Livingston Family Dentistry knows that good dental care ensures overall wellness, and healthy teeth and gums can perfect your smile. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. Ronald and Dr. Blake Livingston take the time to explain every treatment. Their modern office and friendly staff are committed to making you feel comfortable, informed, and satisfied. Located at 13724 Woodward in Highland Park, call now, 313-883-3050.
If your teeth are not becoming to you, then you should be coming to us.
I am back with a gentleman who is just so full of life, who's been all over the way, motivating young people. This is Mr. Jesse Cole Jr. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm great. I am great. I am so impressed with you.
Oh, wow.
And I watched some videos with you and the way you talk to the young people. You kind of engage them, too, because right now you're working with college students, right?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
But you've worked with younger ones.
K through 12.
I know. I know. Let's take a little history, Mr. Pontiac. So you tell us about where you're from. Make sure you talk into the mic nice and loud and clear.
I'm sorry. Well, I'm from Pontiac, Michigan. I grew up there majority of my life. I moved around a lot because my father's a pastor, so we moved around.
Oh, really?
Five different states, but most of my life has been in Pontiac. Most of my professional career has been in education, though. So when I graduated from college,
where'd you go?
I went to Bluefield College, my undergrad, and Concordia University for my graduate.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So when I came back home, from college, you know, couldn't find any work, of course, and riding around the city.
Of course.
Was riding around the city, and the community centers that I grew up in and the parks that I grew up in were all shutting down. And I was riding through the city. I remember almost coming to tears, like, man, what are these kids going to do? You know, I remember growing up going to a community center and being there all day and getting free lunch and playing pool and basketball and swimming. And the next generation wouldn't be able to do that because the community centers were being boarded up.
It's funny because even with Tegas, she noticed things were being taken away from the young people.
Right.
And so you noticed that. And so what?
So I had to do something. I didn't have a whole lot of money, but I had a little bit of experience. And so I said, you know what, let me get into these schools. And so my entry was substitute teaching.
Yes.
Yes. And so I started at $80 a day, you know, before taxes, substitute teaching. I did that for about a year or so, and then I got hired in as a dean of students and a basketball coach. And
where was this?
Pontiac Academy for Excellence.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a charter school in Pontiac.
Yes.
And so that's how I got in. And then I worked in five different districts since then.
Did you know Karis Carey?
Carey who?
Karis Carey.
Oh,
that's his name.
No.
Oh, because he was working in a lot of schools in Pontiac.
No,
with
ma'am.
Those kind of programs.
No, ma'am.
So, you were working in that school as a dean.
As a dean of students, working with students and parents. making sure that the students who had behavioral contracts, that they stayed in school, and that we did our best to make sure that we weren't sending them home all the time. And
accountability.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. And one of the most important things that I found was that it wasn't that the students were, quote unquote, being bad. It was that their home life wasn't as good as it could have been. So I made a concerted effort to reach out to the parents to try to let them know, hey, I'm here to support you. I'm not here to, get your kid in trouble. So when the kid did something good, I made sure I called home as well, so they knew that their child was doing good. And that kind of helped me create a thread of connectivity between the school and the parent as well.
So when did you notice that you could take this out further?
It was kind of thrust upon me, really. This is not something that I pursued, but I just saw a need, and I felt like I could fill in the gap.
Right.
And I felt like if I didn't move, nobody else was going to move. So I felt like I had to do something.
Excellent.
At least my piece.
So what happened next? How did you get to the point where you're going around talking to people?
Yeah, so I stopped working there. Then I started working in a school in Dearborn called West Village Academy, which is a charter school. And so it's in Dearborn, but the students were being bused in from Detroit. And most of those young men, they didn't have fathers in their homes. And there was a segment of young men there who had behavioral contracts, and they had a concentrated class where they had class together all the time because they got, quote unquote, in trouble all the time. And so it's about 15 to 16 young men that had that class. And so I went to the principal because I was one of only two African-American men working in that school. The other one was the dean of students, and I was the deputy instructor. And so I said, Principal White, I see that these young men, they keep getting in trouble. I know most of them don't have fathers at home. They have behavioral contracts. Is there something I can do? Can I start a pilot mentoring program? And she said, sure. And so at the time, I was getting some success coaching. And my coach told me, hey, Jesse, you have a book inside of you. I want you to write this book. And so that's where Walk Like a King came from. I wrote that book in 30 days.
Walk Like a King. Yeah. This is Jesse's book.
Right.
One of his books.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. And so we used that book as the curriculum for the 6-week pilot program.
Really?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, okay. And I noticed that you have places in here for the young people to write.
Right. And that was intentional. It's that size because most of our young men in our school at the time, they were below reading level. And so I wanted to make sure that it was palatable enough for them to
Absolutely.
Read. And also, at the end of each chapter, there's a workbook so they can start applying the principles immediately.
Now, you have here, is this your slogan, maximize your greatness?
My slogan is, what you want to become depends on your willingness to become it.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so you can pray all you want to, but until you put some feet to those prayers, it's not going to
happen.
My
Facebook quote was, don't ask God to guide your steps if you're not going to move your feet.
Right, and Frederick Douglass said this. I'm not trying to do a quote war.
Oh, no, I'm not. Hey, I never fight.
Right. So Frederick Douglass said something that just changed my perspective on leadership. He said that I prayed for 20 years for change to happen, but nothing happened until I prayed with my legs.
Right. That was basically the thing. He moved with
your
feet.
There you go. Move with
Unless you move with your feet, because they say God helps those who help themselves.
There you go.
Okay, we finished with the quote war. But Walk Like a King, I am very impressed with the cover, too. I mean, very handsome. Well-groomed. And that's important. When you're dealing with young men, they don't need to see someone standing up who may look sloppy and mm-hmm. They have to aspire to something.
Yes, ma'am.
You never know. There's a responsibility that's involved when you're working with young people.
Yes, ma'am. I always try to get my young people to understand that you are becoming the better version of yourself. So every day you should be trying to become the better. And if you don't know what that looks like, then you can't become that person. And it wasn't until recently that I understood who my better version was. I was doing all this work, right, doing great work, but I didn't really understand who I was going to be at 60, at 70 years. I look forward to becoming an old wise sage. I look forward to that.
Like me, right, I'm an old wise lady. Yeah. No, but you have to go through, you have to go through things.
Yeah, you got to go through the process. And so one thing that I try to ask my young people, the first question I ask them when I'm doing coaching is, why do you think you're here? What is your purpose? And after that, we go into what is your assignment? Because you can have purpose but not know who you're assigned to. Yes, ma'am.
That's interesting.
Yes, ma'am.
Not know who you're assigned to?
Yeah, not know who you're assigned to. So this is great work that we're doing. She was on before me, and she's doing similar work as well. But until I understood who I was assigned to.
What do you mean assigned to?
Right. And so I'm assigned to young people or young leaders who have demonstrated that they are leaders, but they just need somebody to help fill in the gaps. That's who I'm assigned
okay,
to.
Okay. Okay.
Everybody else, they may benefit from the work, but I'm assigned. I am razor sharp effective with that type of person. Why? Because that was me when I was growing up. So
absolutely.
I can identify with them better.
Absolutely. Yeah. So many of us can identify with we look at these young people, right. And like we were talking about earlier, everybody doesn't learn the same way.
Exactly. Exactly. And I gave you the example of my son. You know, he's 3 years old. You know, I'm a coach by nature. This is what I do when I'm here, when I'm at work, when I'm at home, when I'm in a grocery store. This is who I am. I'm not trying to be this. This is who I was created to be, right?
Yeah.
And so my son, he's teaching me how to coach him. So the way I coach you, I can't coach him the same way. He is a kinesthetic learner, you know, with hands-on.
Right.
So a whole lot of barking won't get to. It would shut him down. But if I just show him what to do and I encourage him, he gets it.
Yeah, that's it. But as a parent, we lose our objectivity sometimes. Right. We can't. I used to say, this is before I had kids, I used to say, golly, these kids really like me. I know my kids gonna love me when I start having kids. Oh, my God. It was just a whole different story because I had this different feeling about my kids. Yeah. I expect you to do as well as my students do.
Right.
I mean, all I have to do is get in there and say this.
Because they're connected to the source, so you think they're going to get it first.
Yeah. Right. Yes, right. Yes, right. Absolutely.
Right.
So what did you learn? Like you said, you learned to encourage him.
Yeah, so there's this framework that I've been working on for a while. I call it the 5 T's. And this is how I lead, and this is whoever I'm leading, this is how I lead people. And I'm getting pretty comfortable with this. The 5 T's. It's tell, teach, take by the hand, take a step back, and troubleshoot. The tell is just the dissemination of information, right? This is, you need something, here's information, go do it, right? So if I have a leader that I'm working with that is has self-will and they're self-motivated, all they may need is information. That's a great way to coach them. And then you have the teaching is showing them how to apply that information to their situation, right? Taking them by the hand, that's true discipleship. You're walking with them. When they fall, you're there. When they get up, you're there. When they're crying, you're there. So that's more of a more intimate type of coaching, right? Take a step back. I call that the covered independence phase, where they know what to do, and they're walking it out, but you're not over them now. You're still there. You're in an advisory role now. Whenever they need help, you guys can talk about it, but you're not actually walking with them.
Right.
And then the troubleshoot phase is, okay, if something went wrong, what went wrong? How can we fix it? What's a new solution?
Absolutely, because some people, when they fall down, unless somebody is there to, you know, help them say, well, you could do it. Failure is a part of success.
Right.
Don't you believe?
I believe so.
Uh-huh.
I've learned more by not winning than
yes,
I have by winning.
Yes, I think all of us have.
Yes,
they
yes.
Now you have a book here, Lead with No Apologies.
Lead with No Apologies, yes.
That
yes,
is interesting.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little about it?
Yeah, so I wrote that book. It seems like every time I go through a dark time in life, a book comes out.
I know.
Right, so I was going through a time where I was working at a nonprofit, and it was really... It was a real growth period. If I took my coat off, you would see my war wounds, right?
Yeah,
right.
Okay.
And so, but through that, I learned a lot of lessons. I learned that as a leader, I shouldn't apologize for being who I'm called to be. Sometimes we kind of dim our light because we don't want other people to see the shine.
Oh,
right?
Goodness,
and
yes.
And you know the word says, if I made you to shine, shine. Don't hide this candle up under a bushel or a table. I created you to shine. So everybody has a different shine. So this all this saying is, shine your light. And I'm giving you principles on how to do that, how to shine your light. And whether you're a leader in the school or a nonprofit organization or a Fortune 500 company, these are principles that you can use to boost your influence.
Okay, for example, I mentioned to you that I had been on tour, a couple of national tours, and this one particular one, every weekend I had to leave school every Thursday morning, fly to historically black colleges, meets up with Sister Soldier and Donna Richardson.
Mm-hmm.
And we were on this speaking tour, right? Mm-hmm. But Monday I was back in my school and classroom and everything. I wouldn't talk about it because people, once somebody said to me, said, we don't want to know where you've been.
Right.
You know, so you kind of dim that.
You kind of dumb it down.
And yeah, and the thing about it, they knew where I'd been because the ad was in all the national mm-hmm, magazines, mm-hmm. and there was my picture up there. But here you couldn't tell them about the great, they didn't want to hear about the great people you saw, mm-hmm. about the great historically black colleges mm-hmm. that were doing great things. You just couldn't tell them.
Right. And what I found, and I'm glad that you said that, Ms. Perriman, sometimes our success, I know sometimes we don't look at it as success, we look right. at it as a journey, but yeah. to other people it's like, oh, they're shining their light. Sometimes when we are walking in our purpose or we're being who we're called to be, that is a form of conviction for people who aren't. Right?
And so
instead of being calling them haters, that's an opportunity for us to help them identify what their better version is and help them to become their better version, right? Because we all have different
lanes. Well, as a teacher in education, we've always tried to find what could be the better mm-hmm. part of these children mm-hmm. and let them see, wow, you're really right. good at that.
And you don't have to compete. You don't have, everybody has their own lane. There's enough
everybody,
room for everybody, right?
Everybody.
So that spirit of competition is what keeps us from becoming the better version, because we're on social media. I'm looking at what you're doing. Like, oh, she got a talk show. I can get a talk show. Well, that may not be what you called to do. So let Ms. Perriman do what she called to do, and you do what you called to do.
Well, you know, sometimes people, it's kind of hurtful in a
it
way.
It is.
You know, it is, because you want to say something. Oh, yeah, I learned about this mm-hmm. from that person. But I used to get all into my students mm-hmm. anyway. Mm-hmm. Their success was what I was about.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of times, it's the people, your peer group.
Mm-hmm. Your contemporaries.
What is that?
It's that contemporary competition thing. And one
but
thing,
what if you don't compete? I'm the type of person I give up. I don't compete.
Right, right. Well, and see, that's even that can be unhealthy as well, because if we just give up, then that's a form of.
Well, when
of
I say I give up, I'm not competing with you. I'm just doing my thing.
Oh yeah,
do that.
And here's the wise way to look at that. If I see somebody that's doing something that's great, instead of competing with them, I should be trying to get close to this person and asking them, hey, you know, how did you do this? I've been thinking about this. Maybe they can coach me on becoming my better version, instead of standing off and competing against them. Right,
right, right. And we have to, you know, and it's a shame to hide your light because you don't want to intimidate others.
Yes, that's
it. Or you're afraid how people will take you.
Right.
Isn't that a shame?
That's why we have Leave with No Apologies.
Yes, Leave with No Apologies. 21 ways to boost your influence.
Right, and there are two, maybe three different thoughts of leadership that I subscribe to. You know, John Maxwell. Well, first of all, Jesus said, if you want to be a great leader, you got to be a servant first. You got to serve people.
Absolutely.
Right. So that's one. And John Maxwell said, the leadership is all about influence. One life influencing another. Right. And I really love Miles Monroe's take on it as well. He said, we are not called to lead over people. We are called to leave an area of gifting. We are called to lead in our area
gifting
of gifting.
Dreamers.
Right.
Right. That's fun.
And so if you are displaying your gift, then the right people will be drawn to it.
Well, your first chapter here, work from your heart.
I think that's
what we're talking about.
Right.
When you just do it from your heart, do it for the good. You know that people may need this,
right.
And so you're there to help them out.
Right. Right. You're doing what you believe you've been called to do, and you don't have to worry about trying to gain followers.
Check your ego is another one you have here.
Right.
Tell us about that.
Well, it's not about us, people. It's so much bigger than us.
Life
is bigger than us. Leadership is bigger than us. This world is bigger than us. And so sometimes we tend to lean on our own genius, our own education. Well, I have this degree, or I've had this experience. And that can be unhealthy when trying to impact people. And so we have to make sure that our ego is checked when we're serving people, because we can have a judgmental mindset when we're serving people if our ego is in check. We can believe it's all about us. We can believe it's all about servitude when it's all about servitude.
I think when you serve, it's all about the people you serve.
It's all about and you're using your gift to do that.
Right.
So in that, you are shining your light.
Absolutely, right. Absolutely. Donald Trump needs to read that chapter. I'm serious. Protect your influence. What is that?
Well, we all have influence, right? We all have an area where we can impact the lives of people. So we have to understand. I believe in that chapter, I talk about when somebody gives you their influence, it's your responsibility to protect it, right?
So
for instance, right, if you said, Jesse, I see you're doing this good work. I know somebody in New York who can help you, right?
Yeah.
And so when you get there, this is their name, whatever. So when I get to New York and I meet this person, I have to make sure that I'm my character is good, that I'm presenting myself properly, because guess what? Your name on that.
Your name is on that. That is very, very important.
Yeah, yeah.
That is very important. That's why you got to watch who you do recommendations for.
Right.
I'm real serious about that. You have one about maximizing your opportunities.
Yeah, maximizing your opportunities. Sometimes we miss opportunities because we don't expect them or our expectation is low.
Yeah, or we're fear.
Fear.
Yeah. Fear. People are afraid of failure.
That's what we're
talking
about.
But if you don't try, you'll never know.
For me, there is either I win or I learn. I never lose. I never lose. Either I win, either I'm successful, or I'm learning a lesson in the process that's going to help me be successful in the future. There's no losing.
Okay, right, absolutely. Right. Well, embrace the sting. What is that?
Woo. That is one of my favorite chapters in that book right there.
What is that?
That is the backbone of this book right here. So I was telling you about that dark time I was having.
Yes.
Right? And, you know, I was in a leadership position, and the people that I was influencing, they were giving me a lot of negative feedback, or they would, you know, we call it hate and stuff like that. And so I felt it. I've never really felt it at that level before.
Mm-hmm.
And I began to search myself. Is there something wrong with me? Am I doing something wrong? And I began to, you know, talk to my mentors, older, wiser people, asking them, okay, this is the situation. These are both sides. Let me know how I can work through this stuff. And I kept getting feedback, Jess, you got to go through this in order to get better on the other side. So that sting that you feel when you're going through a dark time or somebody not treating you right, sometimes we have to feel that sting in order to become the better version of ourselves. I call it cupcakes and bullets. Sometimes life is cupcakes, it's easy. Sometimes it's you dodging bullets. But you have to embrace that sting.
Yes, and sometimes, like, you go to a new job and you bring something different to the job place that can enhance the job place, there's sometimes people around there, they feel threatened because they have to up their game.
Right, right. Insecure.
Yeah, insecure.
Yeah.
But sometimes those people can start coming down on you like you're doing something wrong when you're just doing the best you can or the best you know how. Maybe you know something that can enhance the entire department or the job place.
And everybody doesn't see it that way. So now I've learned that whenever that happens, it's my responsibility to not play the victim. And it's my responsibility not to look at that as negative feedback, but to go to them and actually face the fire. Like, okay, listen, this is who I am. I see a light in you too. How can I help you? How can I add value to your life? Like that's big for me to be able to, for anybody
to
be able to do
and
that.
I think about black men, black women. You come to a place, people have expectations.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I first went to teach in Southfield and, you know, we still had a lot of white kids in the school, black kids, whatever. The kids were fine, but it was some of the adults that really perplexed me because the first year I was in the teacher's lounge across the hall from my room, and this one man, he said, oh, some of these kids are, I want to lynch them. Lynch.
Wow.
When I heard that word, it just, and I had to say something. I mean, I took him to task on that word. And he said, well, I didn't mean it like that. I don't care what you meant. You said this.
Yes, ma'am.
And so another white lady came to me later. She said, you really made me think about that and how words, you know, words really have an impact. And also there was sometimes I started taking my students outside of the school to perform in some of the Detroit schools. One guy broke my props so that I couldn't go. We went anyway. But it was just so, one day I had to take these two Caucasian men, I took them into the copy machine room because I was getting ready to turn into black woman. But I just told them a thing or two about a thing or two. I said, it didn't stop them. They kept on, but I rose to the occasion because mm-hmm. every day I had to talk to my mother. Mm-hmm. I had to call her. I said, I don't know what they're trying to do to me. Are mm-hmm. they trying to destroy me over here? Mm-hmm. And she said, never let them see you sweat mm-hmm. and all this stuff. And just keep on doing what you're doing. Right. And that's where I think a lot of people make mistakes. They stop doing what they're mm-hmm. doing, even though it proves successful for their constituency. Mm-hmm. It was successful for the students. I couldn't worry about mm-hmm. what happened with those men, you good know, stuff. But it was hard.
I'm glad you took that opportunity to influence them, though.
It was hard. Yeah, well,
I'm pretty sure, but you embraced the sting and you kept doing
it. I was the last woman standing, and go. I was the first black department chair in Southfield Public Schools.
There you go. What a great feat.
I mean, you know, it just, people had faith, and it was hard, and I'm glad I stuck to it. But the thing about it is, a lot of people don't stick to it.
Yeah, you have to. Yeah, I mean, the
you become stronger.
You do. And the experience is greater than the uncertainty, right? And so just imagine if you would have stopped, if they're breaking your props and you're getting all of this
right.
negativity. If you would have said, you know what, I quit. I'm going to go work somewhere where I know they're going to really appreciate, where I can identify with.
I was already somewhere in Highland Park. Right, I said, and now I've gone. I've left.
Right, but you stuck it
HP, out. But I did stick out. Yeah. I stick it out. It was hard.
Yes, ma'am.
Hurt, but it did stick. I stuck it out, and that was part of my little legacy.
There
you
go.
But
you're stronger
this,
for it.
You have no a good good company here. You say you have a chapter on good company.
Yeah, that's just having the right people around you. Understanding, first of all, in order to have the right people around you, got to understand who you are and what you offer, what you put on the table. At least from my experience, having the right people around you that not only that can support you, but you can add value to their lives as well.
Okay, so where do you find these people?
Right, that's a great question. There's a lot of people, isn't it?
A lot of people. And how do you cut through who are just with you because of who you know?
Yeah, and it takes, for me, I can only speak from my lived experience. For me, it really took understanding who I was and identifying that same spirit in other people. They may not be doing the same thing I may be doing. Like, I have friends who are architects. They're not doing this kind of work, but we have the same spirit. And they celebrate me for my work, and I celebrate them for their work.
Well, how could people get your book?
Yeah, so it's on Amazon. You can go to Amazon.com and type in Walk Like a King or Leave With No Apologies.
Leave With No Apologies, right. Walk Like a King. Right. Now, you're at Wayne County Community College now.
Yes.
And what are you doing?
So I'm working with a partnership between Wayne County Community College and the Detroit Chamber. A few months ago, the mayor, he made an announcement about going to school for 2 years for free. And so I work as one of the coaches.
Anyway, don't worry about that. I don't know what that is.
That may be somebody calling you.
No, don't worry about that. No. Yes. Telemarketers.
How
do telemarketers get your cell phone number?
I don't know.
I hate them.
Yeah.
Anyway, so you conduit between the chamber
and WC3. So we have students who are from Detroit, graduated from a Detroit high school. They have their first 2 years of school, college paid for if they go to one of the five schools that we have partnerships with. And so we have coaches like me.
What are the five schools?
So Wayne County Community College, Oakland Community College, Henry Ford College now, Schoolcraft, and Macomb Community College.
Oh, wonderful.
Right.
So how do people find out about this program?
Yeah. And so the mayor, he announced it in the summer, but you can go to DetroitPromise.com.
Oh, who's the head of that?
Well, not Detroit College Promise. It's called Detroit Promise.
Detroit Promise.
Yeah, those are two different programs.
Okay. Yeah. I got it.
You have DetroitPromise.com, and you find information there. And so what I do is when the students come in, I am their success coach. I help make sure that their transition is smooth and keep them engaged in the whole process.
Right. This is wonderful. Once again, DetroitPromise.com. Mm-hmm. And Jesse's books, Walk Like a King, and Lead With No Apologies.
Yeah.
Will they get to, who would you advise? I would advise people who may have a young person who maybe this is their last year of school, or maybe they finished school in June and still are wondering, what am I going to do?
Right. And so this, the Lead With No Apologies, that book is for anybody who understands that they are a leader, but they just need somebody to help them fill in the gaps. They may need some supplemental instruction, or they may need a reminder or a refresher, or they're searching for, who am I as a leader and what do I need to do right now? That book is for them.
DetroitPromise.com.
Yep. And then my website is Jesse jessespeaks.com.
Jesse Speaks.
Yep, J-E-S-S-E.
He is dynamic, yeah. Everyone. Yeah. You see that. You see that here. I had two dynamic speakers on this morning. Just passionate about what they do. I really appreciate you
Thank
coming.
Thank you for having me here. I appreciate it.
Oh, no problem. Remember, Table Talk is next, and I have Darnell and Ken, and we have some talking to do. So stay tuned for Table Talk with Brenda Perryman in just a few minutes. And call in.